And we're going to be showing that tonight. It's a short film, a short evangelistic film. I want you to come for it. And we're going to make that film available to you should you desire to show it. Now, I have this long title for these messages. What is that long title? These. Let's say that together. Ready? These, okay? What do we talk about the last week or so? Okay. Well, we visited with the disciples, the post-resurrection disciples last week. Don't yawn yet. Give me a chance. Just kidding. All right. The post-resurrection disciples, something happened there. Even though the risen Christ in his resurrected body came literally, am I right? Came through a wall when they were meeting. I mean, he told doubting Thomas, he said, reach hither thy finger and see that it's flesh and bone. It is flesh and bone, but it's resurrection flesh and bone. The Lord Jesus, and look, I mean, this is beyond our little, like I say, I know I use that little term pea brain, but I mean, praise God for the brain that we have, amen, that gets us around, all right? And we're able to verbalize and we're able to get from point A to point B, thank God, we're able to eat and stay alive. But I can't conceive of a human body being able to get through, I guess unless you watch Star Trek, okay, right? Scotty, beam me up, beam me down, whatever. So, but Jesus, he met those disciples, didn't he? In their backslidden state. They went back. Peter said, I go a fishing. Now that isn't like, Bert, that's not like, oh, well, we'll just throw a line in the water and see if we can catch something, you know, for fun. No, no, this was like they were going back to their commercial fishing operation, okay? And so he looked at Peter, and there was a lot of details there. Peter was somehow naked out in the boat and threw himself in, and he was totally embarrassed by the Lord, wasn't he? And so here's this disciple who said, I'll never deny you. I'm strong. And we know what happened. I had the privilege of being outside Caiaphas's palace. It wasn't a big palace, but it was the place where Caiaphas lived. And outside that palace, Brother Frank, they have a statue of a crow, or a rooster. Excuse me. They have a statue of a rooster out there, reminding the whole world: this right here in this spot is where Peter denied the Lord Jesus three times. And so, our Lord said, "Lovest thou me more than these?" Do you, Peter, love me more than any of these other disciples? The answer to that was probably not. I think John probably loved the Lord Jesus. He's the one that leaned on his breast, right? Or it could have been that, lovest thou me more than these? Do you love me more than you love these disciples? Or do you love me? Next. We're going to go next. Keep going. Next. Yeah, that's it. You love me more than these? And then I really think probably, and I don't really care which one of these you want to take. Because the question is still the same, right? Do you love me, Peter? Do we love the Lord Jesus Christ? Okay. So it doesn't matter if the Lord Jesus was saying, do you love me more than these disciples? Do you love me more than you love those disciples? Or do you love me more than these fish, these 153 fish I gave you? They toiled all night and took up what?
Nothing.
And we made the point that when you get out of the will of God, when you run from God, you'll come up empty every time. You will. When you run to the Lord, you'll come up full. You will. And the Lord will bless you. Okay? And then Sunday night, we talked about, next, go back two, I think it is. If you could. We can. Yep, that's it. The these of the spiritual seeker. And what is that? Seek ye what? First, the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all what? These things will be added unto you. You know what? If you seek God with all of your heart, he's going to take care of your needs. You honor him. Honor him with the first fruits. You live for him. I can give testimony over these last 60 years that God has provided every need. And he's been good to me. My life, compared to this incredible disintegrating world, has been a dream. I made that trip across this great nation from California to a little town called Watertown, Wisconsin. But in that little city, that little town, there was a college that God raised up. And there was revival on that college. I can't even explain to you the revival there was on that. I don't mean crazy fire. I mean Holy Ghost fire. I mean the Holy Spirit worked in that place in a special way. Did he not, honey?
I can't even begin to tell you.
And as I've traveled across this nation, around the world, God's been good when I've sought him.
And he has added all these things unto me.
And we could have many of you stand up and give testimony to that.
All right. We want to go back to number one now. Two. Why don't you go back two?
Now, those are some positive things. I want to cover something very serious this morning. Okay? Very serious. Proverbs chapter 6. And you have mercy on me this morning. Don't get offended. I'm going to be preaching to myself. You want to listen while I preach to myself? You do that. Quiet your hearts. I want you to listen. What's the first word of verse 16? Anybody? These. Again, what's the first word? These. What do you think the most important word is in that verse? These. Let's read it together, shall we, everyone? These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him. All week long, I've been meditating, and it's been a challenge, believe me. It can be depressing, because I was preparing myself for this moment, this message, all week long. I hate sin. Now, this is for Bob, okay? This is for you, Bob. I've been to a lot of places, but I've never been in the town of Cahoots. Apparently, you can't go alone. You have to be in cahoots with someone, right? I've also never been in the city of Cognito either. I hear no one recognizes you there. I have, however, been in Sain. They don't have an airport. You have to be driven there. I've made several trips. I've also been in the land of sin. We live in sin all of our life. We were born in sin. By the way, that was supposed to be a little funny, okay? That's all right. That's enough of that. I talked to a lady who was an elderly lady in her 80s. And she said, "It used to be we rocked around the clock. Now we just limp around the block."
We got that third. Can we get that third video on sin? And that's kind of what we do. We limp around the block. See if that works.
If it doesn't work, that's all right. These six things. Let's read it again, verse 16. Everyone. Let me know if it works. "These six things doth the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination to him." What do you think God thinks of sin? He hates it. You say, what's the problem in America? Sin. What's the problem in our government? Sin. What's the problem in our colleges? Sin. What's the problem in our schools? Sin. What's the problem in our families? Sin. What's the problem in our own lives? Sin. Satan wants to destroy you. Is this going to work? Let's try it. Satan's strategy is simple. Go ahead.
Satan's strategy is simple in your life. Make sin look normal and make righteousness seem strange. The believer's strategy is also simple. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. If you're a Christian, you need to constantly be on guard to anything that dulls your conscience to the sinfulness of sin. The shows you watch, the music you listen to, and the people you interact with matter. You are constantly being molded. Satan's strategy is simple in your life. Make sin.
Listen to it again. Go.
And look normal and make righteousness seem strange. The believer's strategy is also simple. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. If you're a Christian, you need to constantly be on guard to anything that dulls your conscience to the sinfulness of sin. The shows you watch, the music you listen to, and the people you interact with matter. You are constantly being molded. Satan's strategy is simple in your life.
Three? No. Okay, that's enough.
That's good stuff, amen. These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination to him. Let's read them together. Wow, what interesting what he puts number one. Ready? A proud look, everyone, a proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, and heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, feet that be swift in running to mischief, a false witness that speaketh lies, and he that soweth discord among the brethren. God's people said.
Amen.
Wow. We've come a long way the wrong way in our country. Now I don't watch this at all. Many years ago, I might have seen a little clip of it, but I do not watch Bill Maher. Some of you probably do watch Bill Maher. He's not a very godly man whatsoever. But in 2019, he had a program. And he made the statement that there are those who think that men can menstruate. And he was laughed off. He just laughed. Everybody laughed. And he remembered that. And he came back a few months ago and he made that same statement. And everyone said, "Oh, yeah, men can menstruate." That's how far we've come. It's crazy. It really is. Sin is a monster of such awful mien that to be hurt, that to be hated needs but to be seen. But seen too oft, familiar of face, first we endure, then pity and embrace. Sin grows, beloved.
2019, just in the last 3 or 4 years, this whole issue of gender. Well, gender is fluid now, right? That's why I think it's careful what you wear and what you look like. If you are a biological male, you ought to look like a biological male. If you're a biological female, you should look that way. Amen?
Yeah.
You should. All right? Shouldn't be. God made two genders. Didn't say he made 3 or 4, 10 or 12 or 20. Or 100. 4 years ago, pedophilia was something considered wicked, right? And now, pedophilia is, you know, it's a desire you're born with. And now we drag our children to drag shows. Well, we don't, but there are those who do. I mean, this is crazy, this world we live in. And if we don't take steps in our own personal lives, we are going to be swallowed up in it. Did you hear that little statement? Sin is a monster of such awful mien that to be hated needs to be seen. But seen too oft, familiar of face, first we endure, then pity, then embrace. You think biological males should be able to go into the bathroom of a female's? I mean, this is, you think that biological males should be able to compete against the girls in our high schools and colleges? I mean, this is crazy, and the world looks at us. We lead the world in wickedness, and we wonder why our military is disintegrating. And I felt bad. I heard about some soldiers down in Australia were killed yesterday. Beloved, God hates sin. And if God hates it, we should hate it. A proud look. Wow. Let's just put it in a simple term. God hates pride. He hates it. God wants us to be humble. And let me tell you something. We have a lot to be humble about. Man, I was reading something yesterday. I got my old, this Bible here. You say, what's that Bible? That's the first Bible given to me by Pastor Dr. G. Archer Winogur in Oakland, California when I got saved. And he gave me that. As you can see, I devoured it. I don't know where the cover is. I want you to go to Matthew chapter 23. I want you to see this. There were people in his day who were proud. They were called Pharisees and scribes, right? Matthew 23 and verse 12, it says, "And whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased, and he that shall humble himself shall be exalted." In the very next words he says, Matthew 23:13, read it with me, will you? "But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for ye neither go in yourselves, neither suffer them that are entering in to go in." You're blocking them to go in, right? Don't get in the way of somebody who wants to come to Jesus. That's a very serious thing. Oh, by the way, that blasphemer I told you about last week, I got the nicest card I could find. And I wrote him a note. I said, "I came by your door, and I said, maybe you don't even remember me, but you'll remember where I got. I had a tract.
So I took that tract that he ripped it up and cursed me and cursed my God. Blank you and blank your God and blank church and blank religion, and slammed the door. I was looking at the cats. I thought, those poor cats had to listen to that. He had a couple of cats. And he ripped that tract and threw it out. So I took the tract home and I prayed over it. And I prayed for him all week long. And I taped it back together. And I found the nicest card I could find. I said, look, I'm really, if I interrupted you, I apologize. I just want you to know. Oh, the last thing he said, you're just some con man. I said, I'm not a con man. I've been serving Jesus for 50 years. I said, I just came by your door to be a blessing. I don't want one thing from you. I just want you to know that Jesus loves you, and so do I. And I left him a little $5 offer. I said, go get a cup of coffee on Jesus, will you? I'm waiting to hear from him.
We'll see.
We'll see. He might walk in here and shoot me. I don't know. Here's what I'm saying. I want to say something to you today. The Pharisees were religious. They went to church, quote, temple, synagogue. Okay? Somebody sent this to me. And I'm speaking again to myself. If I go to church to become offended, I'll succeed. If I go to church looking for imperfection, I'll find it. If you go to church looking for places where people fall short, you'll find them. Hey, you know what? If you go to church looking for a typo in the bulletin, you'll find it. Or on the screen. The screen's not perfect, Pastor. Well, yeah, it's kind of put together by somebody who's not perfect. Amen. If you go to church looking for imperfection, you're going to find it. But if you go to church looking for an opportunity to worship alongside broken people just like you, you'll find it. If you go to church looking for a place to serve, you'll find one. We got stuff for you to do. If you want to come up to me after service, say, I'd like to serve the Lord. If you go to church looking to love people like Jesus, you can. 10 out of 10 times, you're going to find pretty much what you're looking for. And I was shocked, I'll be honest with you, that Jesus, he targeted the religious community, the people who claim to love God, but they hated him because he was God. He says, woe unto you. And you go into this. What's the next verse? Verse 14. Read it with me. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you devour houses, and for a pretense make long prayer. Therefore you shall receive the greater damnation. Man, that was pretty strong, wasn't it? How about the next verse? Anybody? Let's go. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. You compass sea and land to make one proselyte, and when he is made, you make him twofold more the child of hell than yourselves. Again, verse 16, everybody. Woe unto you, ye blind guides, which say, whosoever shall swear by the temple, it is nothing, but whosoever shall swear by the gold of the temple, he is a debtor. Verse 23. So we're on the fifth woe. There's eight of them. Eight woes for people who are religious and clean and, you know, but inside, they're clean outside maybe, but they're real dirty inside. They got horrible attitudes, wickedness in their heart. They obey certain commands outwardly, but inwardly, they aren't serving. See, we need to go beyond just Well, I do this for God, and I do that for God. We need to get into our motivation and our attitudes, right? What are we doing these things for? Well, we're certainly not doing them to get to heaven, amen? We're doing them because we love the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we're out there in that heat yesterday. It wasn't to make a show, that's for sure. Let's read verse 23, everybody. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These ought ye to have done and not to leave the other undone. What's he saying there? He's saying we ought to tithe. Amen. We ought to give. We ought to tithe. But we also ought to have mercy and faith and proper judgment, right? Once again, verse 25, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, you make clean the outside of the cup and the body, but within are full of extortion and excess. Verse 27, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, ye are like unto whited sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but inward, but are within full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness. Wow. So you can appear outwardly righteous, right? Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because you build the tombs of the prophets. Right? Let's go over to Luke quickly. It's Luke 18. Yes, Luke 18. I want to give you a parable that Jesus gave. We're not going to get very far in this. God says the sin of... there's a proud look. Maybe you know a family member. Maybe you know a politician. Maybe you know a preacher.
And they have a proud look. Lord, have mercy on us.
Luke 18, are you there? How many are there? You there? Okay, here we go. Verse 9. I absolutely love this parable. It's a parable, but I'm sure it happened in many ways. Verse 9, everybody, I'll read it and then you can join me. And he spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men went up to the temple to pray, the one a Pharisee and the other a publican,
tax collector, right?
The Pharisee stood and prayed. Now, this is interesting because he didn't really pray. He talked to himself and told himself how good he was. Okay? So he says this. Pharisee stood and prayed with it. Notice he's prayed thus with himself. I don't know if God even heard it. I suppose he did. But
God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican.
Right? And look at this. He's praying to himself.
I fast twice in a week. I give tithes at all I possess.
And the publican. So that, he sure built himself up pretty good, didn't he? And then here's this poor publican down there, and he knows he's a sinner. You cannot be saved unless you realize you are a sinner. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Okay? Romans 5:12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Amen. So, sin got us in this mess. You say, well, how's that? Well, the devil came and tempted Eve, right? And then Adam. And that's why we're in the mess we are. And here's what's happened. Sin has kind of snowballed, right? Snowballed. And it's gotten worse. It got so bad, God literally had to send a flood, right? And then he sent his word. He sent the prophets. He sends the word of God. And here we are. We got churches. We got hymnals. We got broadcasts and telecasts and internet. and we use them all for the Lord. But we seem to be getting wickeder and wickeder. Not just the world, but even in our churches. Because the world moves way here, and we tend to move in the way of the world. But that's not our rule of faith and practice. It's right here. The answer is what the publican did. Verse 13, let's read it together, everybody.
Here's the answer. Ready? And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God be merciful to me, a sinner. Everyone, verse 14, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other, for everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Amen. Now look, folks, I got an old flesh in me. And I know there's a great study we call hamartiology. What is hamartiology, you say? That's the doctrine of sin. You see, I believe in total depravity. I don't know if you want to call that Calvinist or not. I believe in total depravity. What do I mean by total depravity, Brother Louis? I say, what do I mean by that? I'm just asking you. Right? Yep. Here's what I believe total depravity means. I believe in total depravity. That every compartment of our being is affected by sin. Okay? Our spirit is affected by sin. That's why we need to be what? Born again. Amen. All right. My brain, even my mental capacity, is affected by sin. That's why sometimes I don't think right. And I think pretty much everybody here will say our body's affected by sin. God's people said. I mean, and one day we're going to get a new body, and we're going to get a new brain. And we're going to be able to take in all the glories of heaven because the Lord Jesus is going to give us a new body, new brain, new everything. We are under sin. And so, what's the job of the preacher? Let's go to Romans chapter 7. Boy, Romans deals with sin, right? All through the book. So we got a proud look, a lying tongue, false witness, hands that shed innocent blood that might remind you of the abortion industry, right? Heart devising evil, feet running to mischief. Oh, how about that last one? Sowing discord among the brethren. You know what? We need to be unifying. We need to be unifying and edifying. I'm not saying everybody says something good all the time. They don't. We don't. And we have disagreements. That doesn't mean we need to attack each other. Let's pray for each other. Now here's one of the roughest responsibilities of the preacher. Romans chapter 7 and verse 13. Romans 7 verse 13. And it says there, was then that which was good made death unto me? God forbid, but sin, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandment might become what? Exceeding sinful. We need to hate sin, folks. We need to. Spurgeon says this quickly. Beware of light thoughts of sin. At the time of conversion, the conscience is so tender that we are afraid of the slightest sin. Young converts have a holy timidity, a godly fear lest they should offend against God. How true. So we palliate sin, we throw a cloak over it. We call it dainty names. You see here today, instead of calling it adultery, we call it an affair,
right? Instead of calling it a death style or sodomy, we call it a, you know, an alternate lifestyle, and, you know, even a preferred lifestyle, because, you know, they don't reproduce, and so we're not going to have overpopulation if everybody's a sodomite.
Well, there's a statement for you. God hates sin. And not just, beloved, not just the sins of the world, the flesh, but also the sins of the spirit. I want you to notice 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1. And what I want you to do is become sensitive to sin in your life and ask God to show you and deal with you about your own personal sin. It's always easy to point out the sin of somebody else. Amen? Oh, yeah. Let them have it. Let them have it, Lord.
What you see in 2 Corinthians 7, verse 1, it says, "Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God." God wants us to be pure. Sins against a holy God, sins against His love, His blood, sins against His righteous laws, sins against His name and cause, sins immense as is the sea, from them all He cleanseth me. We need to understand the immensity and the intensity and the propensity that we have to sin. It's our old nature. It's our nature. And so we need to ask God to do a work of His Holy Spirit to cleanse us by His precious blood. The answer is Christ. I'm going to tell you something. You listen to me now. You listen to me, church. Sin will cost you more than you want to pay, and it will keep you longer than you want to stay. And these years, I've had to go into situations. I had one last week. Horrible situation. But we have to try to pick up the pieces of sinful lives and say, it's going to be all right. Ron Hamilton, years ago, he's in heaven now. He wrote a song. I want you to look it up. "My sin is ever before me, Lord." And we're all going to sin, every one of us. And when you do sin, God says, "Come to me."
Now, man, like Adam, when Adam sinned, what did he do? He ran and he hid, right? And he tried to get those fig leaves, or, you know.
As we look at the life of David, we like to point at him and say, "Look at the terrible sin he did." And he did. But there's something different about David than us. You know what David did when he sinned? He repented. He did. But what he did is he didn't run away from God. He ran to the Lord in his sin. That's the key to the Christian life. You don't run away from God when you sin. You go to Him. And you say, "Lord, I confess my sin," 1 John 1:7.
And He says something wonderful. If I confess my sin, then He is able to forgive me of my sin and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness, the sins I don't even know about that offend Him.
Oh, wow. I wonder how many of us prayed this week, "Lord, show me any sin that would grieve You and limit You and quench You, Holy Spirit. Uncover any hidden sin in my life that I may cleanse it. I ask You to cleanse me."
In conclusion, I wanted to go to Isaiah 53. "He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement, the payment, the punishment for our peace was upon Him." And so He was wounded for us, right? He was bruised for us. He shed His blood for us. All right. Psalm 139, and I'm done. Say, when is this pain going to stop, Pastor?
Let's go to Psalm 139. I'm trying to help you tonight, today. And I encourage you to go through Psalm 139. What a beautiful, precious psalm it is. It's a penitential psalm, in a way. Psalm 139, next. Okay. Pride. I don't know if there's another. Okay, that's it, yeah. Psalm 139, quickly, verse 23. Everybody, let's read it together, everybody. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. Everyone, verse 24, Psalm 139, 24. And see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Look, I'm not trying to pick on you this morning, okay? I'm not trying to make you feel bad or guilty. I'm trying to help you. I want you to go to the Lord yourself. And you ask him, search me, O Lord. Let him do, you know, you've heard this, some of you. Let him do some open heart surgery. Amen.
Open heart surgery. And let him search. But just open up your heart and let him see inside.
And let him take the scalpel of his word and cut out what it is that is grieving to him and weighing you down. Maybe it's a TV show that you're watching that maybe you ought not watch.
Maybe. Maybe it's an app on your phone that needs to be in the trash.
Maybe it's how I use my time. My precious queen, she'll tell me, watch your time, Cliff. Ask God, what does the psalmist say here? Verse 23, everybody, let's read it again. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. Boy, that's right down to where we are, isn't it? Lord, are there thoughts that I have that I shouldn't? How about my affections? How about my attitude? Do I have a good attitude, a proper attitude? How about my spirit? Is there a root of bitterness in my life? Wow. I'm here to tell you, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Lord's going to raise up a standard against him. And I'm here to tell you in Romans 5, in verse 20, it says, where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Amen? We should have had a thunderous amen. I mean, I'll say it again. Where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Amen? That's why this young man was baptized. Sin had a hold of him. Am I right, buddy? But he finally came to himself. Like that prodigal son, right?
Hey, man. I'm down here with the hog pen of the world. And these husks. Man. They don't satisfy me.
He came to himself. He said, you know, man alive, even the servants of my father are living better than I am. I'm getting up. I'm going home. And that's what he did.
Greater is he who's in you than he that's in the world.
You don't have to live a life of sin. There is an escape. There is a way out. Life is short. Death is sure. Sin the cause. Christ the cure. Let's stand again. Boy, I wanted to tell you about George Menzig. While we're getting ready for the invitation, I'll tell you about George Menzik. Some of you have heard about him. In the front of my Bible, I have a little spiritual history. Here.
The top of this page, this worn out page, is the name George Menzik. And that went there about 48 years ago, maybe. I was just a little Bible college student. And Dr. Cederholm got up, and,
"Well, students, we have somebody very special here to speak to us today."
And this big, burly guy.
And he talked like this. He came up. "I want to talk to you, students."
Say, who is George Menzik? George Menzik was the personal bodyguard of Al Capone. The great, probably the greatest mobster in American history. And Al Capone,
he asked the same question that Jesus asked his disciples. He said, "Georgie, do you love me?"
"Oh, Al, you know I love you."
Somebody had hit him in his throat. And so he had this gravelly voice. He said, "I want you to go home and kill your wife and daughter." Oh, his wife was a Christian. And so was his little daughter. Long story short, he lived in an upper apartment in Chicago, Cicero, where there's a great church, by the way. Denny Carroll, I preached there many times. And he went in, and he couldn't find him in the living room. He couldn't find him in the kitchen. He couldn't find him in the dining room. But he heard a voice back in the bedroom, and here was his little daughter and his wife next to the bed praying for him to be saved. And George Menzik, that wicked, hardened man who came in with his gun to kill his wife and his daughter, God, the Holy Spirit, gripped him with conviction. This little daughter praying for him. And she looked down, he looked down at her. She looked up and said, "Daddy." And he said, "You don't think God would save a wicked, filthy sinner like me, do you?" And that little girl, it's like those kids yesterday we saw, three precious children outside of Frank's house, looked up at her daddy and said, "Daddy, Jesus will save anyone who comes to him by faith." And he fell down next to her and received Christ and never went back. And he ended up being an evangelist. He had a number of bullets in him. He finally died of lead poisoning. I mean, you talk about, man, somebody with a past. But the Lord Jesus changed George Menzik. And fearless, totally fearless. He didn't care. "Go ahead, kill me. I'm going to heaven." We're going to sing this song. Let's bow for prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for this time. Lord, if God could save a George Menzik, he'd save anybody. If he could save me, you could save anybody. I ask and pray right now, Lord Jesus, that you'll touch and speak to each of our hearts. This isn't for our neighbor. It's not for our spouse, not for our wife or our husband. This is for us personally, each one. Thank you, Lord, that David didn't say, "Well, search my wife or wives. Search my children. Search me, O God." And I hope that each one of us will take a spiritual inventory. If there's any attitude or spirit or issues that we have spiritually that's keeping us from full fellowship. Oh, we want more of this, Lord. We want more of what we saw today in Marin Diaz.
We're hungry. We're thirsty. We want to see an unceasing flow of baptismal candidates. And we know that takes place by shoe leather and heart work. Hard work and heart work. Help us be willing to go. I wonder how many would say, Pastor, pray for me. I'm not sure about my personal salvation, but I'd like to be. Anybody like that? You say, pray for me. I want to make sure. I want my sins to be forgiven under the blood of Christ. You see, Christ doesn't just save from hell. He saves from sin. When we're saved from sin, then we're saved from hell. That's how it works. Maybe you're here as a Christian and you say, well, I've got some things in my life I need straightened out. And we're going to have folks here who can pray with you. You come, and we got a little altar over here on my right, your left, over here on my left, and your right. Both sides. They're for you. Now's the day. Today's the time. You come today. The Lord will bless you. Father in heaven, speak to all of our hearts. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Search me, O God. Know my heart today. I would say maybe next to Just As I Am, my favorite invitation hymn. You come. If there's some business you need to take care of, you take care of it. Come on.